Okay, everybody, welcome. Welcome to Sharkfest. This is, I think, maybe the eighth, maybe 2000, since 2008, I believe, was the first Sharkfest. So I see a lot of repeat customers, a lot of repeat faces in the audience, so welcome back. For those of you, how many of you are, this is your first session, first time attending? Whoa. Whoa. Okay, so in case you haven't figured it out, this is all about protocol analysis. There's not a whole lot of marketing going on. I do work for Riverbed. So why is that significant? Because Riverbed is a corporate sponsor of Wireshark. However, we keep a very tight fence, a strict fence, between open source Wireshark project and Riverbed corporate entity. In fact, I get a lot of emails working for Riverbed saying, hey, you know, can we fix this with Wireshark, or can we do this with Wireshark for our customers? And I always say the same thing, right? Go talk to the developers. Go to ask.wireshark.org and figure it out. Because we don't influence it, because it's a slippery slope, right? So, you know, our founder made it very clear when Case Technology, which was a previous corporate sponsor of Wireshark, was acquired by Riverbed, that we would keep the fundamental things about open source exactly that way, open source, right? And I think it stood the test of time. I know initially there were some concerns and consternation by core developers that, oh, no, you know, a corporate evil corporation purchased open source and it's going to go to hell in a handbasket, but that didn't happen. And proof is the Sharkfest. It continues on, right, with very little marketing overhead. And if there is marketing sessions, I think it's clearly identified that it's a product discussion, for example. Okay? So,
free alcohol.
Yeah, free alcohol. The other thing is, up until last year, so why am I here talking to you guys? Because I've been a troubleshooter for about 25 years now. Hardcore routing and switching background. In fact, I was 9 months ago, I worked for Citigroup, Citibank, Citi, and a part of the architecture team, the data center branch and performance engineering, right? I also own all the tools and sniffers, et cetera, used by Citi. And because it's a 300,000 man company, it's big, right? And some of the traces that you'll see here are, you know, kind of the remnants of that. And what makes troubleshooting difficult in a large environment is the size, right? Everyone does pretty much everything the same way. The routing is routing, redundancy is redundancy, BGP is BGP, OSPF is OSPF, okay? But there are bugs and strange goings on, both with Steelhead, Junipers, proxies, blue coats, whatever your vendor, we seem to hit these odd bugs because of the size. Okay, so that's my background. There is one thing that I'm going to amend here. So this presentation is going to be recorded. I'm recording it right now, as a matter of fact. And it's going to go up on a couple different places. But let me just type it in here. Oops. There we go. What is it? Yeah, YouTube.com. I guess it doesn't matter, but... So tonight, I'll upload it to, make sure I typed it, even though my slash is wrong, youtube.com/Hansang, and I spelled it wrong too. How about that? Nice. I need a little missing B there. All right, here we go. Okay. So this session will be, I'm actually doing the Camtasia recording right now, and it'll be uploaded hopefully tonight. Okay. So if you have any questions, the only thing that I would ask of you is that I do have hearing loss. I have moderate hearing loss. It's been confirmed by doctors due to some loud noise exposure when I was younger. So if you ask a question, by all means, shout it out or relay it for me, for those folks in the front, so I can answer. And then I'll repeat the question. I got a little tag here that says repeat the question, dummy, so that I noticed that when I listened to, you know, some of the feedback that I got was, hey, during your presentation, you answer a question, but we only hear the answer, right? It's not like Jeopardy. I give you the answer, but they don't know what the question was, okay? So hopefully I'll remember to repeat the question, and I need your help. If I don't do it, please shout out, repeat the question, dummy, all right? So what is this session about? This one's a little bit different than the Wireshark and the large enterprise session that I have, okay? The session for the large enterprise is kind of 10, 15 minute short hit and run troubleshooting. I present the problem, I give you the solution, and I give you how my team or I solve that problem. So it's very, you know, just 10, 15 minutes per problem. This one's a little bit more open. This session is all about, there are some odd things happening on the network today, and I'll show you some of the things. And as troubleshooters, it's very difficult to work in that world because the normal rules no longer apply. And the bane of my existence used to be duplex mismatches, and now I would say it's TCP offload engines, okay? Because depending on where you're capturing from, you might see a 64-byte frame, okay? We know that's impossible even with jumbo frames because they only go up to about 9K. So how do you have a packet capture with 64K in a single packet? Well, that's because it's TCP offloading, and depending on where WinPCAP is or LIPCAP is, you're only seeing the logical streaming of the data before it gets packetized by lower layers. Okay, and now lower layers means the network card itself. Okay? So we'll see some how that can interact and interfere with troubleshooting. Okay, all right, so the first one is this. Hidden dangers of data center migration. I promised Kim in our marketing department that I would write this white paper, and I've been pretty busy in getting it done. I'm almost done. But why do I have this white paper for data center migration? Because there's a right way to do it and there's a stupid way to do it. Okay? And we at Citi did it a stupid way once long ago. And I vowed to myself, never again. Okay? My team is the Uber troubleshooters, and we ended up troubleshooting outage after outage after outage after outage. Why? Because some applications only work month end, quarter end, some, you know, witching cycle, some other cycle that only exposed its ugly head long after the migration was done. Okay? Part of that was because we trusted the developers. Okay? It's not picking on developers, but developers are human too, right? They understand their core technology. Web server guys know their web servers inside and out. The middleware guys know their middleware inside and out. And the database guys knows their database inside and out. This is why when you're troubleshooting, everybody seems to say, yep, my silo is good. How many of you have heard that, right? Nothing's working, but every expert on the call is saying, yep, my domain is good to go. So why isn't it working? Okay. And part of that is because as application folks, you worry about your little silo, and everything else is a service. Everything else is a utility. Okay? You don't care about LDAP. Why should you care? Your application is not LDAP. It uses LDAP. Okay? Single sign-on, same thing. I'm a web developer writing maybe mobile banking application. Why do I care what single sign-on is doing? The problem is that application ecosystem is what makes the application tick. So if any part of that is broken, it's not going to work. Okay? And as network, how many of you are network in the network engineering department for the most part? Okay, a little less than I thought. How about application? How many in app dev? Anybody? One? Okay. Anybody from storage? One person. Anybody from security? Okay, I'm running out of room. Anybody DB? Are there any DBAs here? No DBAs? Nobody? Up there? You guys are laughing. No DBAs up there? All right, so all the problems today that we're going to see was caused by databases, all right? No, that's not true. That's not true. But I'm sure all of you, how many on the security side, how many of you heard, oh, firewall must be dropping packets, right? How many of you heard, oh, it's a network is slow. The network's not slow. The application may be slow. But which part of the application, okay? So there's no good way to do this unless you use NetFlow, okay? You have to use NetFlow because it's the only scalable solution to get a handle on what the hell your applications are doing. As network infrastructure folks, we've been very good at our jobs, I think, for the most part, right? And sometimes I used to sit in my office at Citi and kind of put my feet up and say, I don't even know how this is working. I can't believe that it's not a house of cards that everybody's crumbling down, right? Because it's so massive, and yet it just keeps on ticking. So when we talk to and engage application developers, we start with the application diagram. I promise we'll get to packet traces in a second. And they all have this, what I call the magical line. Okay, so they have an application flow diagram. here's the web infrastructure, and then there's a magical line that connects it to the middleware, okay? Without regard to geography, distance, latency, bandwidth, okay? And as network engineers, you scoff at that, how dare you, right? But we're not any better, because we have nice Visio diagrams of our network infrastructure, and we're deaf, dumb, and blind about what application is running on it, who's using it, how much of each application or business unit is taking care of it, okay? So there has to be a better way. And unfortunately, maybe fortunately, depending on how you look at it, NetFlow is the only guy that will give you that answer. Okay? Without NetFlow, if you don't have NetFlow, the next best thing is running TCP dump or Snoop or Wireshark or et cetera, et cetera. Okay? The problem is it's not scalable. Okay? Because remember, you have to run this on every single application to identify the top talker. So let me show you what I mean by trust but verify. When we used to get an application flow diagram, we would turn on NetFlow, right? I blocked out some parts of it so nobody gets upset. But this is an application diagram. 21 servers are involved in this ecosystem, okay? So trust but verify. You make sure that these servers up here that application people forgot about, no fault of their own, it's not their app. Their app uses these servers up here, okay? It's a utility. Because, quite frankly, how many of us think about the electric company or the gas company or the phone company? The only time we call them or concerned about them is when it doesn't work, right? So this is the trust but verify, okay? Packets don't lie, and so therefore you identify and say, you know what, all of these better move in one shot. Make sense? Okay, so now let's look at it from a packet capture standpoint. Okay, what are some of the ways that we can use? So let's tee up and start with a loser example first. Okay, so by the way, if you notice, my Wireshark looks different. And if you go to wireshark.org, I'm a little embarrassed to say, there's a somewhat dated video blog on how to set up Wireshark. Okay, and I say in that video that my way of setting up Wireshark is the best way. It is. Okay? No question. Okay? It is. But your setup should be the best as well. As long as you stick to one flavor, okay, and use it, that's what's important. But if you don't have one, use mine. Okay? It's got 25 years of School of Hard Knocks built into it. All right, so I added some of these columns, and in my video I show you how to add these. Okay? And I do them because I do pattern recognition, and I'm the biggest fan for a show on National Geographic called Brain Games. How many of you watch Brain Games on National Geographic? Fantastic show, completely appropriate to troubleshooting. Why? Because they tell you how much your brain lies to you every minute, every second. Okay? And there are things that we as humans do that will flabbergast you. I've never seen that before. And for example, as troubleshooters, you need to understand something about people, right? And this is a classic one that they showed on that TV show, right? National Geographic Brain Games. And it was, give me the minimum and maximum number, okay? Just bracket yourself. Just give me the lowest number you think is correct and the highest number that you think is correct, okay? Something in between. And the question is, how many countries are there in Africa? Okay, so I'm going to pick on somebody, right? How many countries in Africa?
55.
Give me the high and the low.
A lot.
Okay, just give me a number. I'm sorry? 35 to 55? Okay, give me another one. How about over here?
30 to 40.
30 to 40. Okay, Betty, give me a number. Two numbers, min, low. 10 to 65, a little better, okay? That, what you just heard just now, is called false confidence, okay? Why wouldn't you say 1 to a million? Then you know you're sure to be right, right? But yet everybody brackets it in and dials it in tight because we don't want to look like stupid people, right? If you say, well, I don't know, it could be one country in a million country, that sounds ludicrous, so we don't do that. When you're troubleshooting, application people, troubleshooters, operations, fall on this trap constantly, okay? You jump to conclusions quickly, you overlook things, Okay, you disregard some things, and one of the things that I love is, and some of you will only get this on your way home, is the only thing that goes away if you ignore it are your teeth. Okay? So for those of you that didn't get that, think about that on your way home, and you'll get it. Okay? The only thing that goes away if you ignore it are your teeth. So today, we're going to go over some of these trace files and get to the nitty-gritty and keep asking ourselves, why is that? Why is it doing this? Why is it doing that? Okay? So this one, I called it a stupid or loser example. Why? Because I only have to go down this much to realize this application is not going to migrate very well if you do it separately, meaning you pick one piece and move it across to another data center in a distant location and bring it together. Move it separately. Okay. Why would you move it separately? Because everybody has a schedule. The more you can offload and move ahead of time, ahead of the data center closure, the easier the workload for everybody else, right? So if you blindly pick this one application up here, 172.16, and move it across, you're in for a world of hurt. Why? Simple. It's ping pong, right? Everybody should be able to spot this right away. It's back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, which means every time, and in fact, you see here that there's about a 40 millisecond latency every other packet, okay? This one's easy. But what are some of the things that kind of jump out at you besides the fact that it's ping pong protocol? We can clearly see it's ping pong protocol, but what else do we see here that makes it interesting?
Okay.
All push. Notice in the information column that everything is pushack, pushack, pushack. Okay. What is push bit? The most misunderstood flag of all time. Okay. It could mean try not to wait for anybody. I'm done giving you the data, go ahead and take off if you can. That's one use of push bit, okay? And in fact, it's actually very, the detailed answer is about 30 minutes long, believe it or not. On the receiver side, it can mean, as soon as you get this, don't keep it in the receive buffer, give it to the application right away. That's another use of push bit, okay? The third one, the one that we're interested in, is that push bits are your danger, danger, Will Robinson signal. When you see a lot of push bits flying around the network, you can automatically think this is going to be a chatty application. Without knowing anything about the application, you see a lot of push bits, the application is interfering with what TCP should be doing, which is streaming data from one location to another. Okay, this is the application saying, I'll give you 50 bytes, you let me know when you're done, I'll give you the next 50. Okay, I'll give you 1,000 bytes, when you're done with that 1,000, I'll give you the next 1,000. Okay, so push bits, when you see push bits, think danger, danger, Will Robinson. Any questions? Okay, so we're not going to spend a whole lot of time on this one. This is pretty easy. So now, let's move up to one that's not so bad or not so good, depending on look at it. Okay. This one's a little better, right? Look at the far right column. Push bits every once in a while, but not too often. It's certainly not every packet. Right, so it's not ping pong. So why is this trace interesting for a deep dive session? Okay, let's take a look. So ignore the first two. First of all, number one, we don't have the syn-synac, right? Which means we don't know what. There are a couple of things that are only exposed in the syn-synac handshake, which are what? Round trip time, guaranteed round trip time. Okay, we can still try and derive what the round trip time might be. We certainly won't get that through syn-synac. What else?
Window size.
Okay. The options, the MSS, we can kind of derive by looking at how much data is flying around the network, but the window size we'll never get. Okay. Because almost all modern day stacks today use window scaling. And that scale factor of how big the window size really is only exposed in the syn-synac. So if you don't catch the syn-synac and you see a window size, for example, here of 36,471, or what Wireshark says is, you know, it should say not calculated window size, but guesstimated window size is 36,471. We don't know if we should multiply this by a factor of 4, by a factor of 16, etc., because that's only exposed in the handshake. But we might be able to derive that information, and we'll do some of that today. Okay? So let's take a look. So we'll ignore the first two. We don't even know where we're capturing the packet, but there are some clues in terms of where we might be doing the packet capture. Okay, so let me give you some helpful hints. Number one, look at the MAC address. Okay, what's the source MAC address here? Okay, some random MAC address of some vendor, right? You see it here for Echo. Okay, what's the destination? It's a router. Okay, let's look at the 10-dot guy. What's the source? It's a Cisco MAC address, and the destination is somebody else. Okay, so using the MAC address, we can sometimes get a clue as to, okay, am I catching it on the receiving side, or am I seeing it from the sending side by the MAC address conversation, right? Clearly, if the source address is a router at MAC, then am I getting that right? Because I'm not catching it from the server, it must be coming from the WAN or the routed network to me, okay? Because the last source MAC was a Cisco router, not a end host. Okay, so let's take a look at this guy. We can see here that he's sending out, the first thing we notice here is a push bit by the client, and it sends about 12 bytes of data. Okay, what that means is this 10-dot guy, the server, the client, doesn't really matter in this context, said, all right, give me the next bit, give me the next bucket, give me the next query. Whatever that 12 bytes is, that's what that push bit represents. And the 192.168 says, I'd be more than happy to do it, and I go all the way down to this guy. Why? Because I have a push bit here. So what did the application just do? The application sent this much data, 1448 times however many packets there are, and the straggler here is 966 bytes, and said, when you're done with this many bytes, I'll give you the next chunk. And that's why we see the push bit here. Okay, he flushed the buffer. Okay. But then the acknowledgement is kind of odd. Why is the acknowledgement odd here? So this packet here, number 10, is acknowledging which packet? It says right here. In my column, I have a thing called ACK4, and it says it's ACKing packet number 8. Okay. We can also look at that by looking at the actual ACK figure, which is 8689. And the next expected sequence number is 8689 here, again, packet number 8. So why is the fact that this guy acknowledging 40 milliseconds later, okay, notice the delta 40 milliseconds later, interesting. Anybody? Why would you stop and go, that's odd? It's a round trip time. What else? Why is it interesting?
It's not acting frame number 9.
That's right. Okay. Maybe not frame number 9, but frame number... When should you acknowledge? Let's go back to that. Yeah, every other full-size packet. Okay. So depending on Unix or Windows, that answer differs. But in this case, there's no reason not to acknowledge these two packets, for example, because they're full-size packets. Okay? We know that because it's 1514 here with all the headers, right? So it doesn't matter, Unix and Microsoft, the difference between the two, which I'll explain, doesn't even come into play. The minute these two packets showed up, I should have seen an acknowledgement come by, but I don't. And you think, well, yeah, but that's okay because this one is 40 milliseconds away. It takes some time for these packets to get there. Makes perfect sense, right? But still, that doesn't explain why, if this is Big Bang, this is a moment in time. Okay, this is a creation time right here. These packets all went flying out the door in microseconds, literally microseconds. Okay. This guy is 40 milliseconds away, round trip time away. I get that. But he acknowledged the whole entire packet train. He acknowledged up to packet number 8. Okay, not packet number 4. Because really, after the first two full-size packets come in, I should have acknowledged the first two. And we're not seeing that. Okay, so that's a little odd. Then this guy acknowledges packet number 9. Why did he acknowledge packet number 9? If this guy waited 40 milliseconds, 39, whatever, okay, why didn't he acknowledge the whole thing? Why did he stop here? Why did he not acknowledge this one? I mean, this one appeared, what, 630 microseconds later? Okay. So why did this guy acknowledge, I'm sorry, this guy, acknowledge packet number 9. Has what?
Application level acknowledgement.
Okay. And why do you say that?
Looking at the length, it's
longer. Exactly right. That's exactly right. So there's a concept in TCP called piggybacking. Okay. I'm going to send you an acknowledgement, but there are some rules about when I send an acknowledgement. But if I have something to send, which I clearly do here, because the length is 12 bytes, I might as well acknowledge whatever I've received so far. What's the harm? Okay? So that's why packet number 11 is acknowledging packet number 9, even though it's only one packet. Okay? Because it's arrived, I'm going to send you data anyway, so I'm going to piggyback my acknowledgement to you. Does that make sense? So far, this is all softball, t-ball stuff. I'm teeing up everything, and there's nothing that difficult about this trace file analysis. Okay? Any questions? So, how much can you transfer? What's the throughput that you can expect for this application? How would you calculate that? If someone says, hey, given this trace, what's the throughput? What's the maximum amount of throughput that I can transfer? What's my SLA? How fast can I transfer whatever it is that I'm transferring here? How can we calculate that? Number of bytes over the 40 millisecond time. Okay, there's a couple different ways to do it. One, if it's not too many, just add it up. It's 1448 times however many plus this straggler here. That's your bucket size. That's how many buckets you can move per round trip time. So imagine this is all liquid, okay, water, sand, whatever, and you're moving 1448 at a time, and you're dumping it into your bucket. And the very last guy is 966 grams, liters, whatever. This is one bucket full, and it takes 40 milliseconds to move this one bucket at a time. Does that make sense? So now the math is very easy. Another way you can do that, I'll show you. What if it's not this easy? What if it's not 8 or 9? What if it's 30, 40, 50, 60 at a time? What if my bucket size is big? Then it's not as easy to calculate, but there are a couple different ways to do it. There are commercial products that do this very, very well, okay? But in Wireshark, it's not readily apparent, so we can cheat. We can export packet dissection to a CSV file, for example. Okay. And we're going to say, you know what? Go ahead and call this foo.csv. And make sure you uncheck the packet detail. What's the packet detail? That's this middle screen here in the background that you see, and it'll print all of these out. I don't really need that. I just need the top level guy here, the top pane. Okay, so I'm going to uncheck that, and I'm going to say go ahead and save this for me. So now it's going to print this top window out into a CSV, and now in Excel I can start to manipulate and play with this. Okay, so let's do that. So here it is. I got a CSV file. Open it up. And the first thing you might have to do, and notice it happened to me automatically, is that it all went into the right columns. Sometimes it doesn't do that, okay? In which case, what you have to do is click on the worksheet and use the function here, my favorite function, the only function I know how to use in Excel, really, is text to columns. Okay, you highlight this whole blob of data. So in other words, in Excel, when you open it for the first time, all of these lines will show up as one column. Then you just highlight it, do text to columns, and then say, yep, it's delimited by commas, and then here they are. Okay? So why is this important? Because I have the length field here, but this is with the headers, isn't it? I want to be able to see this length here, 1448. Everybody see this? Okay. So now what do I do? Well, it's just Excel manipulation. Okay. One way to do it, for example, is find this column of info. Notice that this column has everything that we need, but this little piece right here, 1448, is what we want, because I want to be able to add it up very, very quickly. Okay? So then what you can do is just do a global search and replace for the word length, for example, and change it to tilde. Why tilde? Because then you can use it as a delimiter. Does that make sense? So ideally, you can use awk, you can use, if you're proficient in scripting, you can use scripts to say, hey, I want everything between the word length equals and then the space. Then you would just want to isolate this so that you can total it up. Let me show you what that looks like. So this is kind of like a cooking show where we magically cook the, well, let's wait for it to come up. I think I clicked on it, maybe not. There it is. Oh, sorry, it's coming up, sorry. Do you want to open? No, I don't want to do it. So now what I did was, you notice it looks a little bit different, okay? I separated out the MSS. This is that length equals part. I put it into a separate column, and then I just did a subtotal function, okay, which is right here. Under subtotal function, I said, give me the total, and now you can see that on average, it's shooting about 8K per round trip, okay? There's 8K. There's another 57, okay? Goes up and down, but on average, it's about 8K, 7 to 8K per bucket. Okay? Everybody see how I did that in Excel? This is not an Excel class. I'm not going to dwell on this too much, but I'm sure you know how to do this as well. Okay, so just a tip on how to calculate that. All right, so we now know that we can expect 8,000 bytes per 40 milliseconds. That's our maximum throughput. Doesn't matter what kind of network you have, that's your max. All right? Any questions so far? Yes?
Could we have done that with statistics IO
graph? Yes, you can. You can do it with IO graph by specifying TCP.length in Wireshark. The reason why I don't use that is because from there it's hard to extract out the data. You have to still have to extract the data out of that IO graph and massage it in spreadsheet anyway. So I just kind of skip the middleman and go straight to spreadsheet. Personal choice, personal preference. Okay. All right. So everybody, yes, question. Okay. Yep. So let's see. Let's talk about that. So let me just pick up. By the way, the previous question was, see, you guys are not doing your job. Repeat the question, dummy. The previous question was, couldn't I just use IO graph and chart that and get those subtotals as well? And the answer was, you heard the answer. The next question was, why don't I expose this TCP length and make it a column? Okay, which is right where? Let's see. Where did it go?
It's not in there, Hans. You can't right-click on it. You gotta do it as a custom.
Yeah, that's the problem, right? So there's two problems. One, I guess you can go and create your own custom header, but I'm lazy. I'm expecting to hit right-click and apply as a column. That's all. Okay. That's the only reason. Okay. The other thing is, I'm very, very dogmatic about Wireshark. It better have some clear function that's very useful for me to go to my coveted columns header here. Okay, it's not easy to make it to this column here because I have limited number of space. All right, so I'm very so. But anyway, and I love Jasper. By the way, if you know, Jasper is presenting as well. Jasper. He's German, so it's Jasper. And he had the best line ever. Right, somebody came in and said, why do you have three monitors on your desk? And his answer was, because I can't fit four. Right? It's brilliant. Once you go multi-monitor, there's no going back. Okay. So again, these columns are very, very useful to me. And I like them where they are because I'm used to looking at the screen. All right, so not too complicated. So let's go to the next example. So now we have another example where right away it starts to look good, doesn't it? Okay. Why do I think this is a good candidate for migration? Because we see a boatload of data going in one direction. Everybody see that? 192.168 is sending, doing nothing but sending a lot of data. Correct? So, and do you see any pushes here at all on the right-hand side? No. Yes. Question. So the question was, proud of myself. The question was, in the previous example, how did I find out if it was the application or the network that was causing that 8K bottleneck? Is that the question? And the answer to that is the push bits. Okay, there was a stream of packets coming out, and it was demarked by push bit. It went from client send client asking for something, 12 bytes I think it was, and then a bucket of data or a bunch of data showed up, and then the last packet was demarked by the push bit. Okay, so typically when you see the push bit, that's the application saying, I'm done, what do you got for me next? Okay, if it was a network or TCP, you would see things like TCP zero window and few other things. Okay, any questions so far? Okay, now we'll get to the somewhat interesting one. This looks, on first glance, this looks fantastic. Okay, it looks very efficient. We see some acknowledgments here, of course, but for the most part, we see a lot of unidirectional file transfer, very much like FTP. Okay, so this looks good. So why is this? Why do I have this as a deep dive session? Is it the number of errors that we're seeing? No, not at all. Okay, we can see here that there's what. Couple of Windows updates, one segment lost out of 136,000, for example. Okay, clearly nothing to worry about. Okay, so why is this interesting? Because I noticed this when I looked at and I graphed this under Stevens' graph. Okay, so Stevens' graph is very useful tool to have, and it gives you a quick bird's eye view as I zoom in, okay? But there's something odd going on here. Anybody see kind of the odd thing that's going on here? Okay. Well, there's distinct patterns developing, okay? So each one of these blobs, if I were to zoom in more and more, represents a packet, okay? A chunk of data. So if I zoom in a little bit more, the zooming function is not as useful as it used to be before, but. So each one of these represents a bunch of data, some gap here, bunch of data, some gap, bunch of data, some gap, bunch of data, and then a little straggler, some more, right? And it kind of keeps going, okay? So what this is it's streaming a bunch of data in one shot. We saw that in the previous screen, right? All the 1,500 packets going in one direction, that's this here. Now what's this about, okay? Why do we have these little stragglers showing up everywhere? So that's what caught my eye, and I said, I want to know why. Okay, why is it that we have little stragglers from time to time? Don't you want to? I mean, that's right. And this is why I'm saying you have to keep saying why. Don't just say, yeah, this is a good candidate, move on. Try to figure out why that little dot is sticking out there all by himself. Okay? So let's do that. So because it's like a cooking show, I have it ready to go. So we notice here, the 10.guy sent a push here with some packet, 21 bytes in length. So this is a 10.guy saying, yeah, okay, give me the next chunk. Okay, I don't know if that's the case or not, but this is the 10.guy, the receiver, sending a packet with some data, small amount of data, with a push bit. So this is the start of a new conversation. Okay, I can reasonably conclude that's what this is. Then here we are, off to the races. Okay, this is the 192.168 guy saying, no problem, here you go, choke on this, okay? And as we go down here, I mean, it looks pretty good, right? I mean, that's that straight line that we saw in TCP graph, all of this data flying by, okay? And we come down to here, and we're gonna go down to, in the interest of time, to this guy. So up until now, all you saw from the previous packet where the 10.guy guy said, hey, here's 21 byte question, send me some more stuff. 192.168 started spewing data, and we come to a screeching halt right here. Okay. So the question is, why did we come to a screeching halt right here? What caused the 192.168 to stop for 40 milliseconds, you can see the delta here, for this act to show up? Why is that? That's the question. I'm sorry? Was there enough bytes to fill the TCP window size? Okay. Possibly. Okay. What if it was a receiver buffer that was full? What if the receiver's buffer was full? What would we see here? Zero window. right? The receiver would say, shut up, I'm full. Okay, so let me just digress real quick. I know this is an advanced class, but there's something fundamental that a lot of people miss that I want to tell you guys. What's a buffer? Send buffer and receive buffer. Why is it needed? Because TCP is designed to guarantee delivery, right? What's the textbook answer for TCP? Connection-oriented, stream-based, what else? Guaranteed delivery. Am I missing anything? Flow control, right? Those are your textbook answers. Okay, how is it that TCP can guarantee delivery while UDP cannot? Because TCP employs warehouses. Think of it that way. Your send buffer is nothing more than a warehouse. Okay, when the application gives you a data, a bucket of data, a Word document, print job, whatever that case might be, okay, you as TCP stack put the data that you just got from the application and you stuff it in your warehouse. Why? Because when you send the data out to the wire, and somewhere on the internet, it gets dropped, you cannot go back to the application and say, yeah, sorry, I missed that. Could I get the data again? Okay? You have to go into your warehouse, your send buffer, okay? Go to that shelf and figure out what bytes went missing, pull it out, and you send it out again. When you get in a Windows acknowledgement, okay, or TCP acknowledgement, okay, that's saying, essentially what that's saying is, clear out row A, B, C in your warehouse because I got those. Then you as a sender go into your warehouse, wipe it all out, and now you made room to get more data. Okay? So when your send buffer is full, when your warehouse is full, you can't send anymore. You can't accept any more data from the application because your warehouse is full. On the receiver side, it's the same thing. Okay? The receiver side has this buffer space here so that you can queue up data. It's like going to Disneyland. You got all these people waiting to get online. How do you deal with that? You have these snaking lines of receive buffers, okay? And then they trick you, right? You get to the door and you think, yes, get on the ride. No, another room, another waiting spot. Okay, so those are your receive buffers. When your receive buffer is full, you tell the sender, please stop sending by sending a TCP window size of 0. Okay, any questions so far? So then the question here remains, who stopped this? Why is there a 40 millisecond gap here? Think about that. What would cause something like that to happen? Is it the application that did it? Do we know? Is there a way to kind of maybe figure out to see if, in fact, the application might have put the stops to this transfer? What would we look for if this was the application that put the brakes on this transmission? Yes. Push bit. Do we see a push bit here at all? No. So what other things, what other mechanism in TCP could have possibly stopped this transmission for 40 milliseconds?
The congestion window.
Okay. Congestion window send buffer was full. Very possible. The problem is the send buffer congestion window is never exposed in a packet, and it turns out it's a pain in the ass to calculate. Okay. But we can kind of start to see if a pattern develops. So let's do that. How much data did I transfer up to here? And one of the, I call it the B class celebrity, is bytes in flight. Sometimes I add this to a column, sometimes I don't. And that's one of the reasons why I have all these different, depending on the day and the mood, I have different profiles set up. Okay, but for a real reason, there's a reason why I have multiple profiles set up. So we notice here that 244 bytes, 244, 712 bytes are in flight before an acknowledgement came. Okay, makes sense, right? But how much is the application sending? So let's go back to our original packet, 16572, which is here. Okay, this is the question 21 by question, and this was the start of 192.168 spewing data out. Okay. Where do I need to go to find where the application said, okay, I've given you enough. When you're done with this chunk of data, okay, come back to me for more. How would I find that?
Push
bit. Pretty simple. Okay, so I'm going to say, find the string called push bit and go down from where I am. And it goes all the way down to 16922. Okay, about 200 packets more than what we were at before, where we saw the 40 millisecond delay. And there's about 244,749 bytes in this chunk of data. Okay? So this is actually where the application stepped in and said, I'm done with you. When you're done transferring this data, you come back to me for more. Okay? But in the earlier example, the first one, we don't see a push bit. And yet there's a 40 millisecond delay. That's interesting, right? Everybody get that? So if we saw a push bit here, life would be good because we would know that the application is only giving us 244 bytes, 712 bytes, something or another. Let's see. Sorry. 244,712 bytes. Okay? But it's not the application doing this. So let's look for some other examples. So let's do that. Okay? Let's go to 16912. Okay? Again, we have a big chunk of data. We have the 40 millisecond delay here, but just before that, once again, it's 244,712. Isn't that interesting? There are no coincidences in life. When you see the same number again and again, something is at work to cause that to happen. Make sense? Okay. All right. So let's look for another example, 17105, just to make sure. Okay. Here's the 42 millisecond delay and the packet before it, 244,712. Okay. So why is that significant? Because now we can easily calculate what this application might be doing or what the TCP might be doing by doing some calculation. Okay, 244,712. That's the number of bytes. What's our MSS? Is it 1460?
Yeah, for 15.
It is, right? Everybody, right? New, because I wouldn't have asked you if that was the answer. Okay. Number one, first clue is that every packet is 1448. Okay, why is it 1448 and not 1460? Because we notice that there are TCP options. And in fact, there are 12 bytes, okay, right here, 12 bytes of options. So what that means is the normal 1460 has to be subtracted by 12 bytes. That gives us 1448. Okay, because I'm using a superior RPN calculator, I just hit divide, and it gives me 169 packets. 244,712 bytes fits into 169 packets. Okay? Does that make sense? So what I did was I could have sat here and calculated 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. I could have done that, but by looking at calculating the bytes in flight, I divided it by MSS and came out to 169 packets per chunk before we see this mysterious delay. Why is 169 a bad number? Once again, the hearing loss kicks in. Yeah, so this is the evil odd situation. What's the evil odd situation? Before, I said that traditionally TCP acknowledges every two packets, okay? Which means that if you have even number of packets, every packet will get acknowledged every two packets and your life is good. Here, you get up to packet 168, that's the even number of packets, and then you get this 169, the last byte, the last 1448 byte or some straggler hanging out there causing delayed act to kick in. Okay, and I'll show you some of the delayed act interactions later. So when you have odd number of packets in a chunk, in a packet train, that's no good. Because you're guaranteed to waste at least one round trip time before a delayed acknowledgement timer goes off, typically into 100 milliseconds, 200 milliseconds, etc. And we're going to see some examples of that later. Okay. So again, is it a terrible thing? I am transferring 244,000 bytes at a time. That's not too shabby, right? But being that I am not a control freak, but an optimization freak, right? I spend my all day thinking about how I can shave off a few seconds here and there, okay? Whether it's TV remote programming, I'm famous for that at my house, right? I'll go up to my wife and say, okay, the macro is now 5 seconds faster to do, you know, all of this, okay? She's like, so what? It's like, what do you mean, so what? It's 5 seconds faster, right? And yet I'll spend, you know, 30 minutes watching some stupid show and instead of doing my work until, and then I have to stay up late. So yes, my priorities are completely screwed up. I get that. But whatever I do, I have to be optimized, okay? As I pull into my parking spot, I have to start unclicking my seatbelt. Why? It saves me that few milliseconds, okay? I don't know. It's OCD. But that uniquely qualifies me to be a good performance engineer, okay? Because I want to eke out every last efficiency. So we see examples here where we have 244 bytes 712. And yet, application-wise, it's almost double that. Because we went to, remember when we went from push to push? There was almost, what, 244 plus another 240. So 500 some odd K worth of application size. So we can reasonably conclude the TCP window, the send window, might not be big enough to handle this. Do we know that for a fact? No, we don't, because we don't have the TCP window size. But when we consistently see 244,000 bytes being transferred, there is a limitation built into TCP that's causing that. Okay? Because application certainly isn't doing it. So this is a case of what I call a murder conviction with circumstantial evidence without a body. Okay? That's your job. Very rarely, I don't want to say very rarely, but oftentimes, there is no smoking gun. You just have to gather a lot of circumstantial evidence and get a murder conviction without a body. Okay, that's your job. Any questions on this one so far? Before we go to, yes, one more.
This is probably not service affecting.
Yes, I'm sorry?
This situation is probably not service affecting for the user.
Yeah, so this is a batch update, so it's not, and think about it, right? So let's keep it into perspective. We are still transferring 244,000 bytes in a matter of milliseconds. Right? That's a lot of data, right? So the fact that it's 169 packets instead of 170, is it a big deal? Not in the big, but we now know why there's that little straggler dots hanging out after big transfer, right? Because there was a pause and there's an odd number of packets. So now that might explain why we have those little single dots hanging out there. Okay. Any questions before we get into something really interesting? No more questions? Okay. So this next example, this one is one of the most unique and challenging troubleshooting scenarios that I had to face because conditions kept changing without people telling me that they were changing things. Okay? Very annoying when people do that. So where is it? Okay, so as soon as I find it, there it is. I changed these names. Okay, so this application went through a data center migration just 11 milliseconds apart. And the application went to hell in a handbasket. I mean, the throughput went down the toilet. And they said, oh, you know, the last change that was made was we picked up this application and moved the app server and the two different functions of application 11 milliseconds apart, therefore the network is at fault. And clearly, 11 milliseconds can be a lot. Okay, they're about to go live, they're in a panic mode. My name got mentioned by somebody, and I get this email and said, yeah, sure, we'll help you. Okay, so my team got engaged and we started looking at this. And immediately we notice what? Okay, we notice this ping pong behavior, don't we? So we already know it's going to be horrible because we see this back and forth behavior. 102, 125, 102, 125. Okay? A lot of push bits here. But there's a problem here. Number one, these round trips are not defined by 11 milliseconds. Okay? Look at them. Okay? Some of them are 11, somewhere in the neighborhood of 11 seconds. Some of them are not. I also asked the application guys, hey, I see these pattern developing here. Okay? What pattern did I just notice? That if you notice here on the length field, okay, look what happens in this length field. Okay, three data, three data, three data, three. There's this consistent 3-byte data that gets transmitted. There are no coincidences in life. I asked the application guys, how does your application work exactly? It says, oh, there's kind of a start of field delimiter to let the application know expect something, and that's a 3-byte marker. Okay, I get that. And my question was, well, can't you send the 3-byte and the data in the same stream? Because the application can just pluck out the first three and get the data. And they said, oh, no, you can't do that for whatever reason. This application, commercial off the shelf, starts by sending get ready, that's the 3-byte packet, and then they send the data over. But the data that we're sending is small, isn't it? Right? Notice here, it's 239 bytes, 700, 600, etc. When you have tiny packets, what's the first thing that you have to be concerned about? And the first thing you rule out? Round trip time is one. What else? What else is the even more dangerous when you have tiny packets?
Nagling.
Okay? Nagling is nothing more than try to buffer the data as much as you can before you send it out, so you don't have this constant tiny packets going back and forth. Okay? So in this case, I didn't spend a whole lot of time troubleshooting this, even though in the back of my mind, I kept saying, that's odd. Why would there be these delays of 25 milliseconds, 89 milliseconds? This one is perfectly understandable. It's 11 milliseconds. That's my round trip time. I know it's my network. But these other round trip times seem kind of odd to me, 159. And I thought, well, there's delayed ACK, right? Delayed ACK deadlock that happens. What's a delayed ACK deadlock? Okay. It's a condition where, I don't want to spend too much time on it because this is an advanced session, but it's a condition where I expect to acknowledge every two packets, but you sent me one. Therefore, I'm not going to acknowledge you. And the other guy is saying, well, I'm not going to send you any more until you acknowledge me. And it's a deadlock. Okay? One side is saying, give me more packets before I acknowledge you. And the other guy is saying, I'm not going to give you more packets until you acknowledge me. Okay? So it's a deadlock. But even that didn't make sense because it's 159, there's 35, 163, 71. These delays are all over the place. But I'm busy. Okay? I'm going to table this for now and say, hey, listen, disable the Nagle and you should be okay. And see if the problem goes away. And if it does, at a later time, I might come back and investigate this to see why these delays occurred. Okay? Because it was actually kind of a crunch time for me. So they said, no problem. We did the Nagling on one server because the other one, we needed a different SA team to get involved. So they said, Hansung, it got a little better, but not terribly, not that great. So let's figure out, if we can, which side the Nagle was turned off on. Okay, so let's look at here. So here's a 3-byte packet. Okay, 125 is sending. And by the way, both guys send the 3-byte and the data. Okay, it's a two-way communication. Okay, so looking at this trace file right here where my cursor is, can we figure out if 125 server has Nagle turned off? Is there anything in this trace, in this screen, that tells us, yep, Nagle is on or Nagle is off? Yeah. So two tiny packets left the station almost back to back without waiting for an acknowledgement. The rule of Nagle says you can't do that. You have to get a confirmation before you can send the next packet out. The rule of Nagle is actually pretty interesting. And on that wireshark.org, there's a blog on 30-minute video on Nagle and delayed ACK. Okay, it's a pretty interesting topic. You may not know Nagle as well as you thought, because I certainly didn't, because I had to look up a couple things when I was putting together a presentation. I forgot about a couple of these. Okay, so clearly, this guy, the 3-byte packet and the 193-byte packet left within microseconds of one another. Nagle did not come into play. Okay, so these two packets went, and then this guy acknowledged, okay, packet number 8. But how long did it take him to acknowledge that? 57 milliseconds. This is the part where I said, why is it taking 57 milliseconds? Any question, any answers to why this is 57 milliseconds? What's the rule of acknowledgement? How often do you acknowledge? Every other packet. Okay. But these are Unix servers. Then how does the rule change? Every packet must be full MSS before Unix will acknowledge it. Windows will happily acknowledge any two packet. Unix will only acknowledge two full MSS packets. Okay? Make sense? Okay. So sometimes we can kind of get a signature of what the operating system might be by looking at the ACK behavior. But here, 57 milliseconds is not a boundary number. What's a boundary number? 50 milliseconds, 100 milliseconds, 150, 200. Nobody ever sets the delayed ACK timer at 57. Subtract 11 for round trip time. Great. Okay? We're still talking 40 something. Nobody does that. No one puts 48 milliseconds as a delayed ACK timer. So let's keep going here. So now we see that 102 is sending the data. But what's wrong with this picture? These two packets, 10 and 11. Something is absolutely not right here. It's violating all the rules of TCP. Okay? And you have to be so good at protocol analysis to look at and find these things, because this goes against the rules. Why is it against the rules? Here's the 3-byte get ready packet. Okay, you can see here. And the next packet is 209 packets, but it's 38 milliseconds away. How do we explain this one? Is Nagel on or is Nagel off? The first example was easy, right? This one's easy. Here's a 3-byte, and then instantly the message body gets sent. What about this guy, 102? There's a 3-byte, and then a 38 millisecond delay before we send another one. Why is that? This is the part I struggled with, okay? And I said, is Nagel off? And they say, yeah, Nagel's off. Like, then if Nagel's off, why is there a 38 millisecond delay between the 3-byte and the message body? Because clearly the 125 didn't do it. 125 did exactly what you do when Nagel's turned off. 3-byte packet, immediately followed by the message body. 102 is not doing that.
How confident are you that this remote site really is 11 milliseconds away?
100% guaranteed.
Through all paths.
All path. That's a good one, right? Do we have asymmetry here where potentially the traffic is being rerouted through a longer path, and it's not? It's 11 milliseconds, rock steady. So the question, comment is that Nagel might not be turned off. Sure, we know positively 125 is turned off, but 102, I don't know. But then, what if Nagel is on? If Nagel is on, you cannot send this second packet. Okay, because you have unacknowledged data out there on the network. That's what Nagel says. If you have unacknowledged data, you cannot send the next packet unless a timer goes off. Who sets a timer at 38 milliseconds? No one does that. Minus 11, doesn't matter, okay? So we keep looking. Let's keep looking at other examples. Let's see if we can get a consistent behavior here. Now we have 102 sending 3-byte, followed by a delay for the acknowledgement, and then the data goes out. Now it's acting even more weird. Okay, but ultimately there's about a 30 or so millisecond delay between here and here. Okay, so again, we see this 30 some odd millisecond delay between the 3-byte marker that we see here and the message body here. Okay, and it's inconsistent. Here we have application delay of 1.8 seconds, the delta. Okay, that's fine. Application, you know, spent 1.8 seconds doing something, and then it sent the next byte again, 37 milliseconds later. So I actually questioned the SA and said, guys, did you modify the Nagel timer? And they said, well, how do you do that? I said, okay, well, you didn't do it then. Okay. And it's not something, not every operating system even allows you to change the Nagel timer. It's built into the stack. Okay. So this is the part that I didn't quite understand. But we kind of forged on because we have time pressure. So one of the suggestions was, okay, turn off immediate delayed acknowledgement. Okay, why would delayed acknowledgement help or not help in this case? So the idea here is, even if you get a single packet, acknowledge right away. Why do we say that? Why do we go down this road? Because we know the application sends a small packet and a message body of 200 or so. I didn't want ever to get in a case where the 3-byte message goes, and Nagel's turned off, so he doesn't send anything more until he gets an acknowledgement. So if you get the delayed acknowledgement faster, the message body goes quicker. Okay, I'll show you what I mean by that. So let's look at 125. Notice that 125 sends this 3-byte packet. Okay, that's the 3-byte packet. And how long does it take for the 102 guy to send an acknowledgement? 8 microseconds. Okay. Thereby guaranteeing that if you accidentally turn on Nagel, your penalty is 8 microseconds, right? Because what's the rule of Nagel? Unless if there's unacknowledged data out there, I can't transmit, right? Okay. So in this case, even if someone accidentally turns Nagel back on, the 125 server sends out this 3-byte message within 8 microseconds plus the round trip time. Plus the round trip time, okay? I get a acknowledgement back, and then the application can send the message. And in fact, there's 11 milliseconds right there. You see the delta 11 microseconds. It's perfect. It's working exactly like we thought. The worst case scenario is you pay an 11 millisecond round trip delay. And then we say, well, that's kind of stupid. Who cares if I acknowledge right away? I still have to pay this 11 millisecond penalty, right? So let's keep looking at some more examples. 125 sends a 3-byte packet. 102 immediately acknowledges it. And the other guy sends me 11 milliseconds. So at least I helped in some ways by saying that at worst case scenario, the delay is only 11 milliseconds, right? Because I made the other guy acknowledge right away every single packet. So now let's look at 102. Let's see what 102 is doing. He's off here in La La Land, and he sends out the 3-byte packet, immediately sends out 102. Now we know Nagel's turned off, right? Because these two packets went back to back. Then 102 sent another 3-byte packet, followed by the message packet. And how long did that take here, from here to here? 200 milliseconds. So what's 125 doing? Why is he not acknowledging it? Well, it's not a full MSS packet. Okay, I get that. The rule, remember Unix rule. It has to be two full MSS, but it's not. Okay? But 200 milliseconds went by. Almost every operating system stack has 200 milliseconds as a delayed act timer. Okay? Why is it 200 milliseconds? Because the RFC says recommended is no more than 500 milliseconds, but we think 200 milliseconds is a good number. As a result, almost all stacks use 200 milliseconds as a delayed act timer. Okay? And yet, we still don't see the acknowledgement. So what the hell is 125 doing now? Do you guys see why this is such an interesting trace? Because both sides are breaking rules of TCP randomly. Am I right? Okay. Everybody understand why this is interesting? No, not really? Kind of too early for this session? No? So we keep going. I keep digging and digging and digging. And they keep saying, well, don't worry about it. Now it's a little bit faster. And there's a round trip time of 11 milliseconds because 102 immediately acknowledged. And it's doing exactly what you said, Hansung, that worst case scenario is the 3-byte packet goes out. The guy immediately acknowledges. I only pay 11 millisecond penalty. I said, I don't even want to pay that 11 millisecond penalty. Okay? But you guys aren't playing nice. Your servers are not behaving properly. It's changing. Sometimes it's niggling, sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's niggling, and then immediate act comes back, but there's this 30 millisecond delay. What the hell is that about? Okay. So they said, okay, we'll turn off niggle on both sides. So this is kind of the golden state where both sides are quote-unquote fixed. Okay, that's fine. Let's take a look at what it's doing now. Now we got, so let's start from here. 3-byte marker, the immediately sending 488, so Nagel's turned off on 125 for sure. And then he continues on by sending 3-byte and a marker, but 117 seconds goes by. Okay, that's application delay. Okay, between this message, this 3-byte and the data, this 3-byte message, there was application delay of 117 seconds. I have no control over that. That's fine. But where's the ACK? Why didn't 102 acknowledge? We keep doing this, and we see now 102 is doing this. Okay, 102 is sending 3-byte packet, 3-byte packet, and it's bang, bang, bang. Okay, but yet there's a 200 millisecond delay here, and 125 is still not acknowledging. Okay, this makes no sense. This made no sense to me, and it should make absolutely no sense to you. Maybe not, because you're new to protocol analysis. Okay, but when you get to a certain level, you expect people to play by certain rules. When TCP stacks don't play by the rules, it makes troubleshooting very difficult. Okay. So what does Occam's razor say? Anybody know Occam's razor? Right? If there are any two conditions, right, the simplest one must be the correct answer. Right? What's the other one from Sherlock Holmes? If you ruled out everything that's impossible, then whatever's left, however improbable, must be the answer. We ruled out everything. We ruled out the Nagel. We ruled out delayed ACK. And these application delays that are constantly showing up. Sometimes it's 30 milliseconds. Sometimes the server doesn't even answer for 200 seconds. Okay? It's doing these weird things. So I got on the call with them and said, The TCP stack looks okay. I reviewed the output. There's nothing unusual there other than they turned Nagle off. Okay. Delay timer was the default, factory default, because they didn't change it. I said, your application is interfering with the stack. Your application is doing something that makes no sense. Okay? And they said, no, how do you know that? So we'll look at this packet trace, and I tried to explain this packet trace like I did to you guys, but they're application folks. Okay? And I don't mean that in a pejorative way. Application people don't care about packets. Application people don't care about round trip times. They only care about transaction times. The whole reason why they called me was because these transactions were taking too long. We've already ruled out the Nagle. That's the first thing. We optimized that. We did the delayed ACK as an insurance policy in case someone turns on Nagle again. That still helped, but not 100%. There's still these delays of 100 milliseconds, of 30 milliseconds, consistently showing up. Okay? So I told them, your code is not correct. And they said, no, we've been using this all over the place, and there's nothing new here, nothing different, and therefore, it can't be the code. And I said, oh, no, it is the code. Okay? I said, it is. Because I've ruled out everything else I can possibly rule out from a TCP standpoint. Something is wrong with your code. Share your code with me. Okay? And luckily, I have a rock star on my team who did Java and database development. He's a programmer by heart. He looked at it and he said, Hansa, he goes, every once in a while in this code path, there's a sleep function. I said, what? He goes, there's a sleep function of 100 milliseconds. I said, Zoltan, what does that do? He goes, I don't know. I don't know why you would want a sleep function of 100 milliseconds in there, but it's in there. So we brought it up. A lot of hemming and hawing. Okay, they said, oh, we were debugging the code and we needed these breaks in the code path. I said, okay, well, that explains why sometimes you go to La La Land for 100 milliseconds at a time. Still didn't explain the 31 to 36 milliseconds of delay that we saw previously. Remember that delay, right? The Nagle is turned off, 102 is sending the 3-byte, and then 36 milliseconds later, he sends the message body. And I said, okay, the 100 millisecond timer doesn't explain that because 36 is not 100. Okay, let's keep looking at your code. And they said, no, no, the code is fine. And even my guy, Zoltan, said, yeah, there's no other here, nothing here that represents a 36, can represent 36 millisecond delay. Okay, but then the SA guy has nothing to do with the application on the call says, hey, didn't you guys turn on this code sniffer? Like function, right, to see what the problem was. Didn't we turn on some kind of application logging? He goes, could that be doing it? And everybody said, no, of course not. That's a very low weight and blah, blah, blah. And I said, wait a minute. On this day, because go back to your log, on this date and time, did you have the debugging tool on or off? And they said, it was off. I said, okay, I know that because I got a consistent 11 millisecond round trip penalty, but nothing else. On this day, did you have it on? And they said, yes. I said, okay, I see a 36 millisecond penalty. So let's do an experiment. Turn on your debugging code right now. And they said, well, we don't need the debugging code anymore because you found the problem. I said, I know, but your test server has that logging turned on right now. And they said, well, how do you know that? But because in the packet trace, there's a 36 millisecond delay that cannot be explained by TCP behavior. So it has to be the application. So they logged in and said, oh yeah, sorry, we left this on this server. Okay, what was it doing? Irony of all ironies, they turned on this debugging to troubleshoot this problem, which contributed to 36 millisecond penalty between the 3-byte and the message body. Okay, so that's why even when Nagle was turned off, we saw that 3-byte message going back, going out, followed by 36 or so milliseconds later, the message body going out. Okay? So the reason why, and I'm up against my time here. I didn't realize there's a whole new, another case that I wanted to show you. But in this particular case, okay, the reason why this is a deep dive candidate was, okay, there's so much information here to be gleaned from, but it requires expert analysis. This is not analysis that you make if this is the first time you bring up Wireshark, okay? But this was advertised as an advanced class, okay? And the idea here is you ruled out everything you possibly could, and there's nothing else to ring out from this trace file, and therefore it must be the application, and you have to stand your ground. I could stand my ground because I knew what, you know, my team and I, what we were doing, and we were very opinionated about it, saying it's your application, it's your application. Finally, when they saw the source code, we found the 100 millisecond sleep function, and then we found the debug code. Okay. Any questions on, I know this is not the usual Sharkfest sessions that I do, but this was very interesting because if you're a hot, you know, advanced protocol guy, you need to be able to spot these abnormal behaviors and then make your case. Yes, question. Application. So it's an actually a company that's pretty well known. It's a sniffer for your application. It wasn't a VM problem. What this program does is it embeds itself into the application, into the method classes, and starts to calculate how many Java method classes and .NET method classes were fired off. It's kind of like a sniffer built in within your application. Okay. Any other questions? So there's another session here that I didn't get to, but I'm going to add it to this video, and it's a SSH slow transfer. So, you know what, it kind of worked out. That'll be the teaser for you to go and download this YouTube video, because it's an SSH session that's slow in one direction, and we were able to prove with the packet analysis what the root cause was. Okay, and it actually goes to OpenSSH source code. That's where we found the problem. Okay, all right, thank you very much.